The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to God's house. Welcome to Trinity Lutheran Church and School on this day that the Lord has made, Sunday, the day of our Lord's resurrection. And on the church year calendar, it's the 11th Sunday after Pentecost. I'm Pastor Ted Groth, and some of you maybe have not had opportunity to meet our associate pastor, Pastor John Dolde. He'll be the preacher today, who was ordained and installed on July the 17th. And we're delighted to have him with us. In just a minute, he's going to be continuing just with a few brief remarks, what he has done very helpfully since he began here, and that is outlining some of those things that you can expect from your pastors. I've really appreciated that and hope you have as well. Our Trinity Lutheran School teaching staff will be dedicated for service this morning. It's really a special day. It's a special week. We're now beginning because school will begin on Wednesday. And as we always do, on the first day of school, we have opening chapel. And that's at 8:30. It's here in the sanctuary. You're all invited to that. Moreover, every Wednesday, with a couple exceptions throughout the year where we move to Thursday, but generally every Wednesday, we have chapel at 8:30. The congregation is invited, really, really encouraged, if you're able and desire to be part of that chapel. And there's a picnic today across the street immediately after the divine service, a great chance to get to know our new teachers. We have a couple great new teachers this year. Let me make a few corrections to the bulletin, or just one, really. The hymn of praise today is the Gloria in Excelsis, not This is the Feast. I'd like to also make mention of a conference that was announced last week in Davenport, Iowa. It was called a doxology conference with the theme Christians in a Woke World. And that conference, unfortunately, had to be canceled. Perhaps that pertains to some of you who were looking into it. And I invite Pastor Dolde to share his words.
As Pastor Groth said, this is kind of been a series of announcements. I think this is maybe the seventh thing I've been kind of keeping count. Seventh thing you can kind of expect and ask of us, your pastors, to do for you, and we'd be glad to do that thing for you. And today's focus is going to be on the Holy Absolution, the forgiveness of sins spoken and by us and heard in your ears, something that flows right out of the book of John, chapter 20, and I'll be getting into that a little bit more with the children's message, so you can expect to hear more about that then. But in terms of what you can ask of us to do, well, certainly by coming to church on Saturday or Sunday, you get to hear every single time we meet the words of the forgiveness of your sins pronounced to you in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus. But actually, more than that, if you so desire it, you can ask of us kind of on an individual basis to pronounce the same absolution to you. There's in that setting, there's no hiding behind, well, there's this sin that I have that the pastor doesn't know about, so he probably doesn't mean that sin is forgiven. Well, no, not at all. That's kind of what the invitation is, to do this on an individual basis. You can come to us and divulge those sins, and we have vowed never to divulge those to another, so it's safe with us. It'll just die in our ears once we hear it, and we'll announce to you the grace of God and the forgiveness of your sins. It's meant to unburden you from sin's terrors that may be deeply seated. Maybe there's things in your life that sort of get under your skin from time to time or what have you, but this is good medicine for that sort of thing as well. And by the way, this is something that I intend to take advantage of personally, on a personal level, from a brother pastor in the area, so it's not like we're just saying, oh yeah, you do this, but it's something that that I'll be doing too and making a habit of it. And if you'd like to do the same, make a habit of coming to us and confessing and hearing the forgiveness of sins spoken to you, that's absolutely welcome. We totally welcome that. So there you have it.
please turn to page 167. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please turn in your order of service to the INTROIT. Splendor and majesty are before him. Praise the Lord, all nations.
Extol him, all peoples.
For great is his steadfast love toward us.
And the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Splendor and majesty are before him. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, you have called us to enter your kingdom through the narrow door. Guide us by your word and spirit, and lead us now and always into the feast of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the scripture readings. The Old Testament reading for the 11th Sunday after Pentecost is from Isaiah chapter 66. For I know their works and their thoughts, and the time is coming to gather all nations and tongues, and they shall come and shall see my glory. And I will set a sign among them, and from them I will send survivors to the nations, to Tarshish, Pul, and Lud, who draw the bow, to Tubal and Javan, to the coastlands afar off that have not heard my fame or seen my glory. And they shall declare my glory among the nations. And they shall bring all your brothers from all the nations as an offering to the Lord, on horses and in chariots and in litters and on mules and on dromedaries, to my holy mountain Jerusalem, says the Lord, just as the Israelites bring their grain offering in a clean vessel to the house of the Lord. And some of them also I will take for priests and for Levites, says the Lord. For as the new heavens and the new earth that I make shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your offspring and your name remain. From new moon to new moon, and from Sabbath to Sabbath, all flesh shall come to worship before me, declares the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Fear the Lord, you his saints. Many are the afflictions of the righteous.
But the Lord delivers him out of them all.
The epistle is from Hebrews chapter 12. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline, in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time, as it seemed best to them. But he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Therefore, lift your drooping hands, and strengthen your weak knees, and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. Strive for peace with everyone, and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it many become defiled. That no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. For you know that afterward, when he desired to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no chance to repent, though he sought it with tears. For you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given, if even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 13th chapter. Jesus went on his way through towns and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. And someone said to him, "Lord, will those who are saved be few?" And he said to them, "Strive to enter through the narrow door, for many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. When once the master of the house has risen and shut the door, and you begin to stand outside and to knock at the door, saying, 'Lord, open to us,' then he will answer you, 'I do not know where you come from.' Then you will begin to say, 'We ate and drank in your presence, and you taught in our streets.' But he will say, 'I tell you, I do not know where you come from. Depart from me, all you workers of evil.' In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves cast out. And people will come from east and west, and from north and south, and recline at table in the kingdom of God. And behold, some are last who will be first, and some are first who will be last." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise.
You may be seated. If the children could come forward and take a seat in one of the first three pews, so you could just pile right in here, here, or right here. I'll be right
morning.
Back. So I've done one children's message before on Sunday. I called it the gifts of God in Christ, so in Jesus. This one's also kind of, I think we'll do kind of a series of messages based on that same title, the gifts of God in Christ. And today, as I announced earlier, I think we'll talk about absolution, the holy absolution. And you got to hear that from Pastor Groth just a moment ago. But let me read to you from the book of John where this whole thing comes from. So this is John chapter 20, starting at verse 19. "On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, 'Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you.' And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld.'" I'll point out a couple things that I'd like you to notice about Jesus in this passage. First, look at Jesus and see what he does. He first says, when he appears, so he comes through the locked door, right? They just right through the door. And he says, "Peace be with you." Now, I'm sure they needed that, right? Not many people, does anybody you know walk through locked doors very often? No. Yeah, that's... Yeah. Oh, okay. I stand corrected. No, and when he says, peace be with you, it doesn't mean just, okay, calm down, everybody. Let's not freak out about this. He's actually talking about how God, when he comes to sinful people like me and like you, that could be a scary thing, right? Because God's holy. He wants us to be holy too. But Jesus comes with the forgiveness of sins. And that's why he says, peace be with you. So that you don't have to be afraid when God is in the room, because your sins are forgiven. Then he points them to his hands and his side. Now, why? Does anybody know why Jesus would point them to his hands and his side? What happened to Jesus' hands and his side at one point? Anybody remember? If you look at the statue up here, actually there's kind of a clue there. What's in his hands? Do you see something in his hands? Yeah. Yeah, there's holes in his hands. And if you could see his side, there'd be a hole in his side too, because Jesus was nailed to the cross and the nails went through his hands. So he shows them those things, and here's why. He wants them to know that he is Jesus who is crucified for the forgiveness of their sins. Okay, there's the theme here, forgiveness of sins, and that he also was raised from the dead too. Because he, you know, looks more like this rather than the man hanging on the cross. So the crucified and risen Lord Jesus shows up in their midst, says, peace be with you, and makes it known that that's exactly who he is. Now look also at the way that Jesus sends the disciples, the apostles. He first tells them, peace be with you. Again, he says it again a second time, because this has to do with the forgiveness of sins. And then he speaks in a way that talks about how Jesus himself was sent by God the Father to forgive the world's sins and to withhold forgiveness as well by his death on the cross and his resurrection. So he breathes on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. So he's sending the disciples to do what he himself was sent by God the Father to do. Now, maybe you're confused. All right, that's just fine. That's why I brought my keys. I brought my keys because sometimes we call what's happening here the office of the keys. Now, it doesn't mean that there's an office back here somewhere full of keys. No, we're talking about the job of the forgiveness of sins. So what the forgiveness of sins does is it goes to a door, the narrow door that you'll hear about in just a minute, the narrow door that leads to everlasting life, and it unlocks it and it pulls it open so that you can walk through it and enter into eternal life with God. Now, for those who don't believe in Jesus, that door is locked. They're not able to go through it because they don't even want to. They don't want their sins to be forgiven by Jesus. But that's the beautiful thing about what Jesus does. By dying on the cross, he unlocks the door of the forgiveness of sins, which leads to eternal life, and lets you come in. And that's exactly what you got to hear this morning from your pastor. The sound of a door unlocking when he said, I forgive you your sins in the name of Jesus. And indeed, your sins are forgiven. So you get to enter through that narrow door. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your son Jesus to ultimately forgive our sins by dying on the cross and rising from the dead in order that we may live with you forever inside your heavenly home. Be with us until the end of our life, when you will bring us to that feast around your table and give us your body and blood forever and ever to sustain us and keep us in the forgiveness of sins. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You guys can go back to your seats. Thank you. In the name of Jesus, amen. The question sticks out like a tuba dropped during an orchestra concert and is just as clumsy. Lord, if a few the ones being saved, the person sort of stammers out before Jesus. It's a strange question to ask of one who had just preached repentance for the forgiveness of sins in the face of earthly tragedy. A strange question for one who, with a word, who by the laying upon of his hands cast out a demon that made residence for 18 long years inside a woman bent over by such a spirit, causing her body to be made straight. A strange question to ask the Lord, who had just declared that the kingdom of God is like a grain of mustard seed that a man took and sowed in his garden, and it grew and became a tree, and the birds of the air made nests in its branches, and like leaven that a woman took and hid in 3 measures of flour until it was all leavened. Indeed, to ask, Lord, will those who are saved be few, is quite strange. When Jesus is journeying through cities and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem, where for the whole world's sin he will be nailed to a cross and die in order to forgive them who know not what they do. A strange question for God's Son, who shows himself to be concerned for the entire world's salvation by his works, his teachings, and his self-offering. But it's a question that we'd rather like to know the answer to, isn't it? We hear it asked, and all heads turn to Jesus, who we know knows the answer. Jesus, though, never one to allow a passive audience, drops us in the very middle of the answer, saying, "Y'all, strain every nerve to enter through the narrow door, because many, I say to you, will seek to go into it and will not be able to." The fact that I am now in this picture, in this answer, is not a welcome change for me. I'm no longer the one asking about the salvation of others. Instead, there's a narrow door set before me, and I am surrounded by all humanity, and we collectively are given to strain towards the door, striving after what lies behind it, knowing that the time is coming when the master of the house will rise and shut the door. And I might say, "Lord, excuse me, but I was asking about all those other folks. I assumed I was already saved. Why do you have to make me sweat like that with the threat of hell and all?" But I say to you that Jesus must say such things to men like me and people like you, because though we are in Christ by baptism, most assuredly, though we, by the Holy Spirit's working of repentance, are brought to faith out of unbelief, we are people who have a sinful flesh that strives mightily against the work of God in us. Indeed, our sinful flesh is employee of the month at Unrighteousness Incorporated. And it would much rather strike at that narrow door in fury and rage towards God, who is master of the house, than to be on the other side of that door, eating and drinking with such fools as Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and all the prophets who trusted in that house's master. So indeed, Jesus is right to, by the power of the Holy Spirit, exhort you and me towards the Christian life, a life of straining every nerve in order to enter the narrow door because of that tension we live in as baptized children of God while still in the flesh. The Spirit, that is the Holy Spirit, and our sinful flesh are quite at odds with one another. Therefore, Jesus paints well this picture of one who is under extreme exertion. And he calls us not to reject the Holy Spirit who has been given to us, which, if we were to reject the Holy Spirit, would allow our sinful flesh to do what comes naturally, certainly resulting in nerves quieted for a time and bodies at rest, though outside the narrow door. If such a life sounds easier than a life of straining every nerve towards a narrow door, it's because it is. Make no mistake about that. If you were to reject the Holy Spirit, you'd be able to eat and drink freely before the face of Jesus, really doing whatever most gratifies your sinful flesh. Such a life lets you walk among wide roads, merely hearing the voice of Christ who proclaims a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, but such a life does not obligate you in any way to treasure such a gift as water and word of God poured out upon you in God's triune name. Such a life requires you to heed none of Christ's words, nor to lift a finger, much less strain a nerve, as the Holy Spirit wages war against your sinful flesh. No, such a life means guilt-free indulgence in the flesh's many desires. Desires like sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. But such a life is lived outside the narrow door that opens into God's house. Such a life ends in death and awakens not to everlasting life, but to a second death, to an unending death that is experienced outside the narrow door and which is characterized by the never-ending flow of tears and the violent oscillation of teeth upon teeth. Such a life lived in the lustful wanderings, and I'm literally going to kind of demonstrate what your feet would look like if you lived in these lustful wanderings after the sinful flesh always kind of chasing after unsatiable passions. These cause the Heavenly Father to look at a person's feet who does such things and to say to them, "I tell you, I do not know from where you come. Depart from me, all you workers of evil." And it's not as though the Lord is directionally challenged. For those who join Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all the prophets at Messianic banquet table are said to come from east and west and north and south. But those who reject the Lord's salvation accomplished in Jerusalem by the Lord Jesus Christ, by his dying upon the cross, are cast out of the Master's house, having only caught a glimpse of the unending joy that dwells within the house of the Lord, forever seen on the faces of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and all the prophets, and all there with them. So in order that our bodies might be rescued from the pain of hell, from being shut outside of that narrow door to God's house, Christ Jesus calls us to repentance and faith by stepping into our flesh and walking through our humble village, our lowly city, and in our streets, he calls out, teaching us the way of everlasting life, pointing us to his feet, which are aimed straight at Jerusalem. His feet, which are ready to receive nails, which were meant to punish our sinful flesh. And by receiving those nails into his perfect flesh, Jesus ushers us who are last through the narrow door which leads to eternal life with God. Indeed, we are last, yes. Our sinful flesh gives us no advantage over the whole of humanity when it comes to striving after this narrow door. Our sinful flesh holds us and keeps us at the back of the pack, so to speak, as those who virtue signal boast of a human sort of righteousness as they make their way towards first place. But because of his great love for us, Christ, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, he has girded himself for service, placing himself behind even you and I, who are back of the pack type folks. He grabs the folds of his dazzling white robes and knots them in such a way that he can get down to business. And get down to business he does. He first seats you at the messianic banquet table with God's holy fools, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and the prophets, those whose hope and trust was in a Christ they had not even seen. Then Christ enters back into the kitchen, where he labors mightily over your meal, sweating even drops of blood in preparation of it, and then with great joy, because of the love he has for you and his Father, he gives up his very self, his body and his blood upon Calvary's cross, in order that he might give you the bread of heaven, which gives life to the world, and the fruit of the vine, which he promises to drink with you in God's coming kingdom. Is this not the God-man who became last in order that you become first? Even now, as you, Christian, live this Christian life of straining every nerve as the Spirit wars against your sinful flesh, even now, Christ gives you a foretaste of the feast that is coming in the supper he institutes. When he comes out in servant's clothing and gives you bread, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. You eat it and receive nourishment even now that grants you endurance unto eternal life." When he says, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood," you drink it, and Christ declares your sins forgiven as his last will and testament. Such forgiveness then, as a last will and testament, is certainly carried out in you. As long as you are still in the sinful flesh, though, your nerves will be strained by the Holy Spirit's working in you. But when you die, or when Christ returns, whichever comes first, you will find rest for your souls. This life of straining will be over and will give way to life, true life, lived in the presence of Christ Jesus forever and ever. And with him, around the messianic banquet table, your bodies will receive enduring rest, being nourished forever by the very body and blood of Jesus shed on the cross for you in Jerusalem. And he will join you for that awesome meal. By his answering of that strange question, Lord, will those who are saved be few? By putting us in a place where we must ask ourselves, am I saved? Jesus causes us to recognize the inability of our sinful flesh to make its way into the narrow door by way of self-righteousness. That is to say, Jesus causes us to truly repent, to first of all be terrified by where our sinful flesh would land us if left unhindered, but secondly, Jesus causes us to hope and trust in him alone for the forgiveness of our sins. That is the gospel that comforts terrified consciences. Consciences that ask, will my sinful flesh prevail at the last? To such a conscience, God speaks a sure word of absolution, that in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, who died upon the cross with the whole world's sin, I, the man whose lips move before your eyes, have been sent by God to announce to you the grace of God, to forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And where there is forgiveness of sins, there is life unending and salvation. You have heard that your sins are forgiven for Jesus' sake. And by faith and the Holy Spirit's working within you, you can be certain that your sinful flesh will not prevail in the end. For you are, by baptism, in the one who forgives your sins. You have been baptized into Christ. And all heaven rejoices that you and me, sinners, all of us, are brought to repentance and faith. You will be welcomed by Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and all the prophets, and all who have come from east and west and north and south, and who are seated around Christ's table. There you will join them and eat and drink with them, and will forever be with Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise as we confess the one true Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Congregation may be seated. I'd invite the teachers and staff to come forward and assemble here at the altar rail. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, these servants of the Lord have been called or appointed to serve as teachers and staff members at Trinity Lutheran Church and School, Cedar Rapids, Iowa, for which we give great thanks and praise to God. That includes indeed our TECA as well, Trinity Lutheran School. Now hear the word of the Lord concerning the Christian education of children. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. In Ephesians chapter 6, fathers, Do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. In Proverbs chapter 22, train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it. Trinity Lutheran School was established in 1884 to assist and support Christian fathers and mothers in their God-given duties of bringing their children up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. By the grace of God, Trinity Lutheran School instructs children who seek in a Christian environment such education, knowledge, and skills as will equip them for faith in Christ, godly living, faithful service, and responsible citizenship in their life's work and chosen careers and endeavors. These teachers and staff members have been prepared for service that qualifies them for this work. So, as this 2022-2023 school year begins, I ask you, do each of you willingly and freely assume the responsibilities entrusted to you? And do you promise to do your best to carry out in a God-pleasing manner the special duties assigned to you according to the mission and purpose of Trinity Lutheran Church and School? If so, then answer yes with the help of God. Do you promise to set a Christian example for the students in speech, life, faith, and purity? If so, then answer, yes, by the grace of God.
Yes, by the grace of God.
You have heard the solemn promise of these servants. Will you receive them, show them fitting respect and honor, and pledge to cooperate with and support their work? If so, then answer, we will, with the help of God.
We will, with the help of God.
Beloved fellow servants of the Lord, I dedicate you for Christian service as teachers and support staff of Trinity Lutheran Church and School and TECA in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, for this 2022-2023 school year, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, you have chosen these men and women for special service to your kingdom through Trinity Lutheran. Grant them your Holy Spirit, and through your word of truth, enlighten and equip them with heavenly wisdom for the carrying out of their tasks. Grant them much joy and a spirit of bold trust, that their work may stir up each of us to a life of faith and fruitful service to you, to our students and families, and to our fellow brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord God Almighty, even as you bless your servants with various and unique gifts of the Holy Spirit, continue to grant us the grace to use them always to your honor and glory. We humbly pray that you will continue to make this church and school a center of godly learning and living. Give those who teach knowledge, patience, and a loving spirit, and those who are taught receptive minds and hearts and willingness to learn. Prosper the work of our instructors, students, staff, and all others who assist them in their labors, that your church may be edified and your holy name glorified. To all fathers and mothers, give strength day by day, and increase to them all needed wisdom, humility, diligence, and joy to bring their children up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Servants of God, go in peace and joy. The Almighty and most merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and bless you and strengthen you for faithful service in his name. Amen. This time, our teachers and staff will introduce themselves, beginning over here.
and I work in the cafeteria.
Say it one more time. It got a delay.
I'm Jessica Polk, and I work in the cafeteria.
I'm back here in the corner, just like I was when I was a student. Our school's been here since 1884. I have not. But it's a blessing to still be here at Trinity. And you can see it's pretty cozy up here. It's getting cozy at school, too. We're growing. God's blessing our ministry. I'm Mark Mueller. I serve as principal here at Trinity.
My name is Evan Root. I'm the coordinator of youth and family ministry here at Trinity. I'll be assisting in teaching religion this year, as well as Tekka Chapel.
Stephanie Gemtrude. I'm the Tekka program administrator, and I'm also teaching kindergarten prep.
I'm Ann Schreck. I'm new. I'm going to be doing kindergarten prep with Stephanie.
I'm April Lenhart. I'm going to be Tekka Float, helping all of the ladies there, and then also supervising extended care.
Good morning. I'm Connie Powell, and I teach fourth grade.
I'm Mindy Rottinghouse, and I'm the lead teacher in the First Steps room and the Tekka on-site supervisor.
Jeff Nance, going to be sixth grade homeroom, sixth, seventh, and eighth grade math, and working with curriculum and instruction.
I'm Betty Nance, and I'm third grade.
I'm Amanda Wojak, and I teach preschool.
I'm Sarah Brandt, and I do kindergarten through eighth grade PE.
Good morning. I'm Ellen Schlarman, and I'll be teaching first grade.
I'm Michelle Pins, and I'll help lead First Step room.
I'm Sarah Stutler, and I'm in the Get Set room.
Good morning, I'm Jessica Kinney, and I'm the Assistant Program Administrator for our Early Childhood Program.
I'm Judy Schrader, and I teach Art in Family and Consumer Sciences.
Crystal Krenz, and I teach second grade.
Hi, my name is Katie Smith, and I'm the fifth grade teacher.
My name is Kelly Fisher, and I'm the eighth grade homeroom teacher.
Hi, I'm Lisa Morris, and I'm a preschool assistant.
Hi, I'm Mary Stevens, Resource and Intervention.
I'm short, so I want to come over here. I'm Emily Root, and I teach kindergarten.
I'm Laura Drzycimski, and I teach band for grades 4 through 8, and I this year will be teaching general music for kindergarten through third grade.
I'm Susan Benya. I'm seventh grade homeroom teacher and director of music at the church.
I heard my people from
Let us stand for prayer. We pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, grant us repentant faith to strive to enter ever more deeply into your blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation. By the witness of your saints, gather many from the very corners of this world to enter your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, eternal Lord, you have founded your church and promised that she will remain forever. Bolster her confidence in your word and guide her pastors in paths of righteousness, that she would declare your glory among all nations. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you have called fathers to bring up their children in your fear and love. Sanctify and sustain them through your word, that they would lovingly discipline their children and so show forth your own divine care for your baptized children. Lord, in your mercy. Our gracious Creator, you ordained marriage to be a blessing for husbands, wives, children, and our entire human community. Bless, on the 70th anniversary of their marriage, Keith and Jeanette Wymore. In their daily lives, pour out your benediction upon them and upon all husbands and wives, that they may abide in your sacrificial love and thus be empowered to love and serve one another according to your will. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, grant wisdom, integrity, and skill to our President, the Congress of the United States, our Governor, and all those in authority, that in the exercise of their lawful duties, justice would be maintained, the innocent defended, wickedness restrained, liberty upheld, and consciences respected. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, you chasten those whom you love. Teach your fatherly love to those enduring the afflictions of this life, for all things come from your hand. Guard Deanna Acord, Ron Anderley, Julia Bickle, Jeremy Brown, Carmen D. Catlin, Ruth Hartwig, Dorothy Kame, Dale Larimer, Eleanor Moss, Lincoln Smith, Angelia Wengert, and all who suffer in body and soul, and bring them through their trials. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, we give you thanks for all the saints who have gone before us. Grant that we would die to ourselves and enter with Christ into the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to join with all the angels in festal gathering and to be numbered with the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, perfected in the righteousness of Christ, and abiding forever in his new creation. Lord, in your mercy. To you, O Lord, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all glory, honor, worship, and praise, now and even to the end of all the ages. Amen. You may be seated for the offering. Please stand. We pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
After a brief introduction by the piano, please, the singing begins with the saxophone.
Let us ever walk with Jesus.